I'm excited to be here and to see all of you, particularly on a bright sunny day, come inside to share your words of poetry with other poets and with people who may not necessarily know the power of poetry. Part of my job as West Hartford Poet Laureate, as I see it, is to spread the appreciation of poetry, not only to those of us who are already interested in poetry or writing poetry, but to those who might not see the power of poetry in their lives. So this West Hartford Community TV series, to which Marcia referred, is one in which I have begun by interviewing past Poets Laureate of West Hartford. So my first interview was with Ginny Lo Connors, and if you'd like to see examples of the Poetry in the Parks project, it's on her website, ginnyloconnors.com. So you can actually go and see both the poems and also the beautifully decorated stands that will be back up again this summer. I interviewed Jim Finnegan, and I've also, the next one that will be broadcast will be my interview with Maria Sassi, who was the first Poet Laureate of West Hartford. And with that in mind, I just wanted to let you know that Maria's project, when she was Poet Laureate, was to begin a series of readings at the Noah Webster House over on South Main Street. She sponsors twice a year a poetry reading, including an honorarium, which she funds, and that is what she's doing as our first Poet Laureate in West Hartford. So the next one coming up is going to be May 19th. It's a Thursday night. It's going to feature Pat Hale, Tony Fusco, and Sherry Bedingfield, who is here with us today. I hope that you will attend that and thank Maria for everything that she's done for poetry, because I love to see these projects continue on into the future. So it's really a nice shout out for Maria, and we thank her for that. If you want to see these West Hartford Community Access shows, you can go to their website and you can scroll to Poetry Around the Town and click on Poetry Around the Town, and they're all archived. So you can watch them at 2 a.m. if you'd like, or midnight, or over coffee, or whatever. But I'm really proud to be able to talk to our Poets Laureate. The next one I'll be filming will be with the two owners of the Golden Threads Gallery. If you haven't been to the Golden Threads Gallery, which is part of the Holy Family Monastery on Tungsus Road, they sponsor an art exhibit, and they ask poets to come and write poems to the art. And the current one is called Woman, Fierce Beauty. And I've seen it online. I'm going to go see it in person. It is absolutely stunning. So do get over to the Golden Thread Gallery, and I will be talking to Trisha and Kate in my next interview. So I'm going to read just a couple poems for you. The first couple of poems will be from Blinding Light, which is my full-length collection of poetry. And I'm going to read what has come to be, for whatever reason, kind of my signature poem. It's called Swans and Hearts. At 20, married with a baby girl, my mother stared down days like furrows deep as tractor ruts in mud. She picked up needles, grew expert at knitting Fair Isle collars, Argyle socks, sweaters with moose heads front and back, mohair afghans yellow as an egg yolk. She wrapped us up in deep blue sweaters, knit through hours, waiting for my dad to come back home, knit through broken promises, knit waiting for doctors, calculating how many stitches she had left. My daughter asked for a sweater when she turned 5. She wanted swans and hearts. I, mother of the quick fix, the good enough, always sure the inside wouldn't show, was stumped. Swans and hearts would take some planning. I found my mother's needles in her knitting bag, faded stripes of silk with narrow pockets sewn inside. Did I have it in me, the knowledge of the fingers, which way to wrap the yarn, how to transfer stitches, cast on, cast off. They say it's based on instinct, like mothering, no need for Dr. Spock. I feared I had the instincts of a coat rack. I picked bright pink with white swans on a turquoise sea, coaxed out a pattern, calculated colors, knit one row at a time. The swans and hearts began to grow, separated on the right side, but underneath, linked by strands of pink. Thank you. And I'm going to read the poem that I wrote for Jeannie Connor's poem called Where Flowers Bloom, which were poems all inspired by Elizabeth Park. Portrait in Elizabeth Park. Posed in the gazebo for their photograph, my three girls are framed by roses, hot pink, deep red, pale yellow. Their first unfurling, the scent of innocence on the brink of overwhelming. Eleanor and Susan perch on a wooden bench. Eleanor, the eldest, hovers, ready to rein in the sprawl of Susan, a five-year-old who hasn't learned to pose her legs together. My middle daughter, Claire, has wandered, sits off on the grass, peers into tight petals of a bud as if she could foretell rapture or rejection from its folds. I dress them in flowered chintz, hoping they would complement the garden's bright explosion after months of steady rain and gray days, which seemed required to make me grateful for a garden planted purely for delight. By mid-July, I know the roses will have dried and dulled, the thorns turn brittle, another season looming in the shadow. And think of Mary, when she hoped he might be spared, might stay hers after all, then saw how short the season of his blooming, how soon the shadows would descend. I'm going to end with two short poems from the book called I'm Dating Myself, which is literally about dating myself. So it's also about aging. And well, I can see a couple of you in the room might relate to that. Not very many of you. The first one is called Morning Song, and it actually is about the experience of my daughter, who is in the room, being in her crib in the morning. So I'm reading it in her honor. Morning Song. My bed is a warm nest, sun spilling in the eastern window, a streak of red and yellow leaves, almost at the height of saturation before becoming brittle, turning brown. I burrow down. The birds are chirping a familiar family squabble. I soften my hearing, tune out the discord. Imagine it's one happy family singing a campfire song. Then, across the hall, my baby wakes. I hear her rustle. Then a babble so glorious, as light as lemon meringue, airy with radiance. I want a tape recorded to capture it for winter mornings when she's discovered words. Fearful I'll forget the magic of sounds I can't transcribe, a hymn to all creation, the miracle of morning, a chord that shimmers from her room to mine, inevitable, electric, as if a thousand songbirds perched along a line. And I'm going to end with a poem called Visible, which was inspired by Fern Park in honor of being here in West Hartford and being West Hartford's Poet Laureate. Visible. Beneath the brook that swirls in from the upper bend, then tumbles out of sight beneath a footbridge, Stones shine like gray pearls. Minnows zigzag in their busyness, as if they have a mission, invisible to us. Beneath the brook, my daughters dip their fingers, stir it up, content with just each other and with me, a rare occurrence. The leaves, a patchwork canopy, the grass as soft as prayers. The children babble as if they have a mission, inaudible to me. Beneath my thoughts of dinner, homework done, not done, my struggle to control their juggle for position on our family tree, a language, eerie as a kikawa, bubbles up. Notes of shifting leaves, the water's gloss, bird calls, the minnows with their minnow music. Beneath all this, a moment of pure peace. When a secret life turns palpable, becomes a silken cord that links us to the water, trees, birds, even to the minnows, as if they have a mission to hold us to this place, this grace. Thank you for having me.
Now we'll move on to the main event, and I'd like to introduce our host, Tom Nicotera, who for many of us really needs no introduction at all. But for those not acquainted with him, here are some facts he asked me to share. He's been writing poetry since college when he was a physics major, when he filled his notebooks with poems rather than equations. He's been a factory worker, a street performer, a mime, water and sewer repairman. I'm glad there's something useful here. Copy editor and teacher, while keeping poetry as the one constant in his life. In Washington, D.C., he was a founding member of the Second Wind poetry group and was co-producer of a jazz poetry day at the Washington Monument. He taught at Georgetown University and ran the Tacoma Cafe poetry series in Maryland, and here in Connecticut, he edited Charter Oak Poets 2, a collection of works from area writers. He's published poems in numerous small press publications, and his poems have been performed in the East Haddam Stage Company. He is currently co-host of Bloomfield Library's Wittenberry Poetry Series, a great series, and is a member of the performance poetry trio called Not Just Any Tom, Vic, and Terry. His book of poems, What Better Place Than Here, was published last year by Foothills Publishing. So those are some points in his background, but what I always think of when I think of poets is he's a real thing. So here's our host, Tom Nicotera.
Thank you, Marcia, for that introduction. Wonderful. Thank you, Christine. That was a great reading. Good introduction to what's happening. And also, thank you all for coming to this fabulous audience, and you're going to really enjoy the lineup of poets we have. They're also unique in their perspectives, thus the name, and in their presentation of poetry. We're going to go alphabetical according to the book, and I do want to mention they have books for sale over there, and I'm going to go according to the list of the biographies in the back, and I'll just say a few words from each biography, and then if you want to know more about the poet, you can read the more detailed biographies at the end of the book. The Robert Bellay, is Robert Bellay here? Okay. Getting my numerous notes here in right order. Okay, Robert Bellay. He worked after graduation in industrial libraries, then at Wayne State and Yale, before spending 30 years as reference editor at Choice, where he also edited two editions of Guide to Reference Books. which he found more fun than was quite decent. He is a very recent entry in the poetry sweepstakes, and he hopes his feeble efforts find some favor with experienced practitioners. I'm sure we'll enjoy it. Robert Pelle.
Proceeding would be televised, so I am was terrified when I came in, and I'm very, really relieved now. This is a poem called Something to Pray About. Bright bloom the bursts of fire that end the lives of the Charleston Nine. Bright burns the clapboard siding that shrouds the seven churches. Long stands the memory of stars and bars flying over ragged rebel troops. Long labored the blacks in sugar and cotton with no pay or no say. Free were the blacks that rebels saw on their sweep through the north in 63. Free were the blacks that rebels sent south in chains into slavery. Sweet is the freedom of slaves set loose by Sherman in Georgia. Sweet is the freedom to ride public buses after Rosa sat to ease her feet. Bright shine the license plates on southern cars, recalling a war 150 years gone. Bright shines the sweat of black field hands and road crews in the southern sun. Loud ring the shots at the Memphis Motel and after Emmett Till's whistle at the White Girl. Loud cry the children at the Birmingham Sunday School and rioters in the Blind Pigs on Detroit's 12th Street. Black are the ruins of Charleston houses, raising rafters of despair to the hopeless sky. Black are the faces of slave ships at the markets, Charleston to New Orleans, that dealt in living flesh. Guilty were the princes. Guilty were the princes that sold their subjects into slavery. They knew not where. Guilty were the slavers, throwing the dead overboard into the sea, selling the living at the slave markets. Guilty were the owners and overseers, working slaves to the end of their endurance, housing them in tar paper shacks. Here, slave labor gave whites a false security and blacks a belief that only their sweat had value. Here, whites keep a shaky dominance supported by police, and blacks hide in ghetto houses. Here, slavery makes its last conquest, making all fear the last event that shows the enmity all bear toward everyone they live near. Guilty are they who would hold the trigger of Ruth's pistol and still hold control over blacks.
Thank you. That was Robert Pelle.
Bailey.
Oh, Bailey. Okay. The next poet is Joanne Bauer. And you can hear me okay?
Yeah. Yes.
Okay. Joanne Bauer published a full-length poetry collection, Drawn Parallels, and her first chapbook, Dances with Marks and Mirrors for Finishing Line Press. Locally, she serves on the boards of Riverwood Poetry Series, the West End Poetry Society, and is originator of a Crassus for the National Arts Program and a contest judge for the National Federation of State Poetry Societies. She's been honored as an educational administrator, academic book author, and researcher. visual artist, environmental activist, neighborhood leader, and prize-winning poet. Recently, she enjoyed interviewing facts and poets friends on her creativity show for West Hartford Community TV. And at the end of this month, she'll lead poetry workshops at the Windsor Arts Center. She's a wonderful poet, and I encourage you to check out her books. Joanne Bauer.
Thank you, Tom. And welcome to everyone here. I'm going to read from my full-length collection, Drawn Parallels. And the book is over here somewhere for sale. All of the proceeds from my book go to a fund that I have at the Hartford Foundation for Public Giving. And because this book has been on sale for a while, you can get it for discount today. The project, actually, that started this book was an ekphrasis project, and all of the 70 poems in here are mapped onto, within the appendix you can see, they're mapped onto fairly well-known artwork. And I'm going to read and show you artwork from two of my poems that are ekphrasis. Ekphrasis means poetry written in response to a piece of art. The first one, Before the Lesson, won a second prize award from the Connecticut Poetry Society in 2014. This is the artwork that it responds to. Before the Lesson. A bevy of pubescent girls gaggling in white tutus, some swans, others geese. To the front, neighbor Peg, pudgy and flat-footed, in dance class only because her mom said so. On point, my best friend Sandy, center stage by nature, leans toward the old master, who rests one hand on his cane, both eyes on her. Me against the far wall, withdrawn and sullen, two poses I already know by heart. Preening, cackling, fawning, adjusting, oblivious to joy in movement, and naive about a heritage of wild women dancing. My mirrored tool sisters and I await promised limelight and long-stemmed roses, flower petals fluttering. And the second one is called Drawing Scorn and goes with this image. Unfamiliar with your legend, Lucretia, I view you in folds of fabric, elegantly poised as if you're on toward your future. But with one breast exposed, as if you beckon the boy. I read that your story swirled such unspeakable scandal as to fell the monarchy of mighty Rome. That on a night of your husband's absence in brute battle for his king, would come the sun to your bedroom, despoiling all honor. You with broad hips, Lucretia, and voluptuous beauty, so belying defilement. Woman, were you raped a second time by history and a third by art? Your dagger, disguised in a glint of chalk, drawn as if protection, not rendered true to the bloody blade you would thrust out of unfathomable shame into your own heart.
Thank you. That was Joanne Bauer. I just had an introduction to ekphrastic poetry. In the name of efficiency, when a poet is up here, I'm mostly reading two poems. I'm going to ask you to not applause after each poem, but applause at when the poet is finished. Then you can applause as much as you want. It'll speed things up a little bit. The next poet. Is Joyce Bogdan? Is she here?
Bogdan.
Okay. I remember you from the last couple of times. Joyce Bogdan has been a member of the Facts and Poets since 2009 and is thankful for this group. She has a BS in elementary education at CCSU and an MA and sixth year in education. And she has two new books on Amazon. Campground Flowers, Life at Camp is one of them, and the other is Positive, Poems That Inspire. Joyce Bogdan.
Good afternoon, thank you. I'm happy to be here. I'm happy to be part of the poet, Facts and Poet group. I'm reading two poems this afternoon. I write some poems with from quotes, and they inspire me for the poems. So the first one is Be the Change, and it's from the quote, Be the Change You Want to See in the World by Mahatma Gandhi, a friend of mine. That was her favorite poem, and she asked me to write one for her. So life goes on, day by day, the same schedule, the routine continues, a repeat of places and faces. Why not be different and alter the course? Paradigm your view. Shift your attitude, change yourself to what you want to be, and open up a new world. Second one is soundtrack. And the quote is anonymous. It's from, music is the soundtrack of our lives. Our life has twists and turns. It makes you who you are. But part of our journey is to find words to express the feelings we have inside. We continue to follow the beat. Notes are just stepping stones. Listen, dance, and sing to the music. The lyrics tell the story. They are the soundtracks of our lives. Thank you.
Joyce Bogdan, so if you liked her books, or liked her reading, check out her books on Amazon. Francis Chang, is he here? Ah. Francis Chang, you've been with the group for a long time. I always enjoy your work. He lived a harsh rural life during World War II in Taiwan. There were no toys. Village kids resorted to climbing coconut or beetle trees, pruning sugar canes, and uprooting potato roots for earning dimes. Taking mentors' advice, my siblings and I tried to study under candlelight without electricity. The value of education was unfathomable to shape our lives. Now, he has two doctorates in chemistry and chemical engineering. And lacking literacy training in arts and poetry eclipses fullness of life. Life without arts is dull, is lusterless, diamond stone. What a great statement. And it shows in his poetry. Francis Chang.
I'm very grateful to have this opportunity to read a poem, but to be honest, my background in poetry is a blank sheet. I'm not that creative in writing a poem, but I learn a lot from our member of the Faxon poetry group. And I read Christine's poem, on Waste Hartford movie, I really enjoy it. Also, I have a great honor of meeting Tom once a year. really a rare opportunity. Now I like to read two poems. The first one is Moonlit Beach. Strolling on Moonlit Beach. Mind roiled by surfing tide, soothing breeze can offer for ride. Swooping swallow greet you, strolling with hunched grandpa as kid, holding his cane for support and comfort. stroke had crippled his arm and leg. His shadow balled up like mushroom. Moonlight evoked pensive feeling. Ancestors and parents are now history. As the moon, what shall I be? It brink on receding tide. Strolling on moonlit beach, watching stars, Jupiter and Venus in waste sky, forever together in harmony. The second one is Four Seasons for Country Boy. Little boy, brave, cool spring, venturing outside with running nose, chasing butterflies in prairie, tumbling over with bloody nose, foggy dawning, hero muggy summer, golden retriever chased red fox, little boy jump on pony back, suffering free fall with black eyes, golden forage outshine azure skyline, taking hayride on pumpkin wagon, golden eagle soaring high, migrating geese wave goodbye, dread pumpkin vine, litter on farm, falling snow turn into grimming carpet, milking cow rush into coal barn, fruiting boy comes hard. Thanks so much.
That was Frances Chang. Thank you, Frances. The next poet, Pamela Guinan, she began writing poetry more or less seriously in the 1990s. More recently, she has gathered and cast with poets at the Faxon Library and other specialty vintners, including Word Forge at Billings Forge and the Riverwood Poetry Series and Festival. More recently, she was uncorked at the Connecticut Poetry Society's Middletown chapter, where in December 11, 2011, she began to permit administratively as chapter president. More recently, she began serving as Faxon Poets Keeper of the List, or membership, and on the Connecticut Poetry Society Board as membership chair. Pamela Guinan.
Thank you, Tom. Thank you. My name is Pamela Guinan, and I'd like to begin by saying, over the past 400 years, there have been many names for the area we today call Hartford. Among them are Suckyog, Dutch Point, and Hertford. This poem that I'm going to read celebrates the 100th anniversary of the municipal building, Hartford's Town Hall. The municipal building. Conceived in the heart-warmed hands of men long gone, verily I carry on. Yea, 100 years have come and gone, and still the adventurous blood of men courses through my granite veins with the vitality of the ancestral rivers that flowed through Suckyog. What strength of purpose still parades through my open doors by day. Timeless, spaceless men of clay who bring me news of elemental interludes, of marriages and births, of land resolves and dissolves even death. Energetic and restless in the day's bright light, I find no more restful rest than in the dimmer, starlit light of night. Nay, through the night, the fluid flow of finite forms. ABCs and integers whirl through my halls and doors, float up and down each staircase with grace, and dance like little children across my herringbone ceilings and harlequined granite floors. And then, like wisps of whispers, they point and giggle on tiptoe as they trickle past second-story doors, so not to tax or vex the carrion-eating eagles or the rough-skinned lions made of stone.
100 years have come and gone, and still I wait to them unwearily. Each one vital, these men of clay, each face a marquee, a bloodline byline that shouts in concert. His mother, her father, their child, all mine. I wait to them in peace and storm. I tell you verily, it is for them I carry on. Okay. I'm gonna just do a real. Okay. My next poem is My Knight in Rusting Armor. It was dusk. A simple spring shower sprinkled on down from a rogue cloud, not the only cloud in a blue-gray freckled sky. And yet, this threatening rogue of a cloud had plowed an intersecting path over our evening stroll's trajectory. It might matter most if it weren't merely rain that induced my man, that riled and rallied him so until he ran on home ahead of me, without so much as a word or a by your leave, not a tug, not a wave by that hand at the end of his damp, not yet dripping sleeve. To him, what am I asked myself as I kept walking, and all the while rain kept falling harder and harder on my man as he ran from that sponge-rum freckle of a fickle cloud hung low above our heads and that gray-blue, blue-gray of April sky. It was a little rain, that's all. It's not like it was the last lifeboat lowered over the starboard side of Titanic. From under my poncho, where I was dry, I wondered, does practice really make perfect? Would practice really rally and render my man a prince, make him perfectly pitch perfect? Would he rouse to save, if necessary, someday, like Mighty Mouse? I can't help thinking, if practice makes perfect, how would my sprinter ever really rally to save something, someone beside him, like me? Make me feel like I'm a princess and he's my prince, not just my rousted, routing knight in rusting armor. This one is Serene. Oh, the grays, the whites, the blues, the green, and I, while the seagulls and the egrets preen, I reset myself serene. And then one more last poem. Though 10 feet or better, I like these 7-foot ceilings dropped low above my head, better than the 6 feet below above the dead. Thank you.
That was Pamela Guinan. The next poet, her bio is a poem. It's Cheryl Ann Hale. So what the poem bio says, Cheryl Ann Hale did not go to Yale. No letters prestigious followed her name. Lived her whole life in Connecticut's Vale. Her lunchtime writings will not bring her fame, but she squeezed poetry in just the same. She thinks this bio is sufficient detail. Cheryl Ann Hale.
Two poems. First I was just going to read one, but this one was actually inspired by last year's celebration that we had at the Babson Public Library, where we were all standing under the exit sign. So this poem is called, and it is in the Perspectives 10, Under the Sign. A drum gives heartbeat to a poem about the night. Like misty ancient ritual, they circle around him, transfixed, waiting to add their lines, their stories to collective consciousness. In and out, the circle breathes poems, deep breaths, life, love, loss, death. Inhale each other's pain or joy. Exhale butterflies, flowers, rivers. Some strip naked, down to bare insecurities. Others find humor in its absurdity. Stare down the barrel of life's shotgun, stick out their tongues and smile, daring the world, bring it on. This is sacred right, poetic heartbeat, listen and be heard, feel not diminished for offering up pieces of yourself, but something closer to whole. In the circle, one by one, take a final turn under the exit sign. And the second is by popular request. It's, I hope I'm not offending anybody, I may be ridden out on a rail. It is called, it is a parody on a poem I like very much, but it is called 13 Ways of Looking at Wallace Stevens. Among 20 inscrutable poems, the only moving thing was the eye of the poet. He was of three minds, like a tree in which there are three black poems. The poem whirled in the autumn winds. He was a small part of the pantomime. A man and a woman are one. A man and a woman and a poem are one. I do not know which to prefer, the poems of inflections or the poems of innuendo. The poet whistling, or just after. Icicles filled the long window with barbaric glass. The shadow of his two best lines crossed it to and fro. The puzzle traced in the poem, an indecipherable cause. Oh, thin men of Haddam, where were you when I lived there? Did you not see how the poems walked around the mind of the women about you? I know noble accents and lucid, inescapable rhythms, but I know, too, that poetry is involved in what I know. When the meaning flew out of sight, it marked the edge of one of many mysteries. At the sound of poetry, confusing in green light, even the bawds of euphony would cry out sharply. He rode over Connecticut in a glass coach. Once a fear pierced him, in that he mistook the shadow of inscrutability for poetry. The river is moving, the reader must be crying. It was evening all afternoon, it was snowing, and it was going to snow. The poem dangled from a cedar limb. Thank you.
So now you all are going to have to go back and read Wallace Stevens' 13 Ways of Looking at a Blackbird. That was Cheryl Ann Hale. Thank you. And I want to remind you again, they have books for sale. After we finish, they'd be happy to sell and sign them if you want them to. You could have 28 poets signing one book. The next poet is Andrew Hook. Andrew has been a teacher of ESOL, French, and Spanish. He promotes responsible parenting to first-time fathers in the greater Hartford area. He's involved in social work regarding this, and he loves art, archaeology, theology, and music, and revels in the uselessness of poetry. Andrew Hook.
It's great to be here, and I love being part of the Facts and Poets. It's a really fun group. My first poem is called Eutychus Awakes, and this is based on an interesting incident from the 20th chapter of the Book of Acts, where a young man who was next to a window listening to St. Paul preach on and on and on into the night fell asleep, and he fell out of the window and died and was picked up dead and revived and brought to life again. So first I'll read that scripture, then I'll read my poem. Seated in a window was a young man named Eutychus, who was sinking into a deep sleep as Paul talked on and on. When he was sound asleep, he fell to the ground from the third story and was picked up dead. Ye Olympian poets, hearken well while the fall of a tragic youth I tell. My Lydian lay, unsung by Homer, in pastoral ages far and former, shall warn and chasten your patrician ears, recalling bygone Hellenistic years. Pardon the insufficient gravitas. My intention here is not blasphemous. Saul, since Damascus and his desert days, had progressed to the apostolic phase. A somnolent old town, Trojan Troas, lent him their ears. What we came to know as Western Judeo-Christianity was birthed in near-comic humanity. but St. Paul was completely serious, feverishly focused, quite delirious, foreshadowing from Moses' law the Christ and Gentile nations grafted in or spliced as shoots from a wild rebel olive tree, the eternal one who is Trinity. And many other holy mysteries he taught and unlocked with scriptural keys. The allure of Aegean night was deep, but Saul offered something greater than sleep. Among them languished one barely alert, a young narcoleptic Grecian convert. Eutychus nodded, his frame barely propped by the night-freshened window. He had stopped heeding the rabbi still preaching Jesus. Thus did the youth surrender to Morpheus. Unfortunate, weary, his tired head nods, still exegeting from beyond, Paul plods. Finally, the liminal threshold reach. E falls to encounter the power Paul preached. His toga billowing as he plummets from peaks of Christological summits, he descends to gather cryptic renown and a dubious New Testament crown. Was E bored to death by St. Paul's discourse? Descending from grace, did he stay the course? Was his resurrection a first holy fruit or an arrival by alternate route? One wonders in retrospect, was he saved? Or is this a picture of mankind, depraved, fallen in slumber, oblivious, dead, until truth's unkindness touches our head? Like Lazarus, this one had to die twice. We ask how many more deaths would suffice. Did he talk to the Lord while departed? Could he fathom what Calvary started? Like Luke's blind man, the sin was not his own, but that God's power be openly shown. For his pains, a twofold resurrection, rebirth through Paul and divine election. Unless the whole thing was allegory, mere Jewish fable or pagan story. Don't discount apostolic gravity, nor censure the Lydian levity. Lamenting the youth bored to death by Paul, we discern in Eutychus our own fall. Revived, he learned before the rest of us the difference between Christ and Morpheus. If there be details still to verify or vague scenarios to modify, we shall, in heaven, request to hear it from the lips of Eutychus' own spirit. And then we can corroborate with Paul the how and the who and the wherewithal. My next poem is shorter, and it's in honor of our election year. It's called Dual Airbags. Give him a skinhead, insignia, boots. Less scruples, a swagger stick, crowds, money. No black shirts visible, just business suits, and pride is restored. Tragic, but funny. Proud like a skyscraper, godless as sin, Babylonian promises, towering lies. Reality shows when plutocrats win, their rhetoric raining from empty skies. She-wolves, elected by uninformed sheep, behave predictably, eyeing the flock. Their wool and the lamb chops are hers to keep. Grazing voter, this should come as no shock. It's a bitter pill, more like pilloried. So shall we now be trumped or Hillary?
Thank you. That was Andrew Hooked. Unique perspectives there, for sure. The next poet, Jerome Howard, would be next, but I found out today that he can't be here because he's not feeling well. That's too bad. He always has a good presentation. I know the next poet is here because I talked with her earlier, Lynn Hunter. Lynn Hunter of Canton is a retired primary grade teacher who has written poems on and off throughout her life. She often writes pieces evoking an emotional response and ones that tell of her observations of nature, frequently combining poetry with photographs she has taken. So I would like to bring up Lynn Hunter.
Good afternoon. afternoon. I have two poems for you. Both are from the anthology. The first is called Sustenance. Yellow, yellow, I am of yellow, surrounded by others like me. Upright we are, but swaying in the gentle breeze, opening widely in the warmth of the sun, waiting for water. When it comes, we drink thirstily, starting with our silk-fine roots, bringing the wetness up, up, into the greenness that keeps us standing. When it doesn't come, our blossoms slowly close, shrivel, fall to the ground. Our leaves curl, doing the same. Still no water, we lean over on the parched earth, yellow fading to brown. The second one is called The Swallowtail and the Green Frog, a True Tale. Sitting in the midst of moss, without a ribbit disturbing the silence, intent on insects to ingest, the green frog waits. Swallowtail of indigo sips the nectar from the sweet-smelling hollyhock. Butterfly-laden bloom tips to the waiting amphibian. Sticky tongues springs into action. Green frog dines enthusiastically. Wings swallowed, the green frog waits.
Elizabeth Hunter, do you have a photograph that goes with the frog poem? The next poet, Camelia Donahue Hines, she has found inspiration in nature, the heavens, and personal relationships, specifically from her grandchildren. And she looks forward to the ongoing support she receives from her friends at the Facts and Poets. Welcome, Camelia Donahue Hines.
Thank you, everybody. Good afternoon. I do need the glasses a little bit, so bear with me. Okay. First one is called Fairy Home. She builds a fairy house in the wood. Dragonfly, hummingbird, and moth observe. With stick, leaf, twine, and dandelion could such a dwelling be shaped into curves. Then sewn together with love and great care, dusted with pollen to gleam in the sun, Queen Anne's lace and daisies want to share a place of beauty for fairies to come. In that unique place known to a child, she sees the fairy waft down to her home, and with a gentle heart so pure and mild, opens the door to the fairy alone. Both child and fairy have settled in sleep, finding rest and dreams in the night so deep. And the second one is called Chapel Prayer. It's very short. Held in your hand, I found safety. Held in your love, I found revelation. I learned to breathe, awareness grew. The mountain is steep, strewn with stones of pain. I am not alone, I know better. I look to you. And this one more is called Moon. Eerie light of night insinuates around my window, opening closed eyes as with daytime's blistering eye. Coolness draws a sleepy soul to lift the shade and peer above to Mesmer, who rests elbows on sills and wonders as the secret keeper moves and departs in the shimmering slivers. Oh, harbinger of deep desires, loves, sweet memories forgotten in time, return in fullness to hold this captive enthralled again and again.
Do you read those poems to your grandchildren?
Well, actually, the first one's my 8-year-old granddaughter.
Oh.
And wow. Actually, I print them off and frame one for her, and I have one for my grandson, too.
Great idea. That was Camelia Donahue Hines. The next poet also cannot be here. She's not feeling well. It's Dolores Lawler. She's been with the Facts and Poets a long time. So I miss hearing her, and she's a wonderful master of alliteration. The next poet, and correct me if I'm not saying this right, is Mariad Shaban Lazarus. Is it I saying that right?
No.
No. How is it said?
Moray.
Moray. How about the Shaban part?
Shaban, yes.
Yeah, Siobhan Lazarus. She lives in Glastonbury, Connecticut, earned a bachelor's degree in science, and currently works as a registered nurse. In between writing, she enjoys venturing to the beach, baking, reading, and spending time with her family. And she and her husband have two lovely daughters, Ashley Ivy and Amalia Rose. Married Siobhan Lazarus.
Hello. I have two poems to read today. The first one is called Between. He was okay with it, I think. I think it was his time and we stopped it. I don't feel like I saved a life. I don't think his life will be for the better. I don't think his wife will understand his life now, with his eyes barely open and talking that, worse than before all, this. I'm too spent to cry. I read his eyes right this morning. He is in the between of worlds. And my second poem is called Catherine. The pain, unspokenly deep, my husband doesn't think they count, but it's the pain of birthing, fear really, hopes and dreams so deep, so fine, now, undeep, so unspoken, so, sadness like no other, it's a hard thing to lose a child. Thank you.
Thank you. Marianne? Siobhan Lazarus. The next poet, June Sidran Mamlekar, you should know, is one of the original founders of the Facts and Poets, and she's also the co-editor of the Perspectives book, and has been for past issues. She has a BA from Hunter College in the city of New York and an MS in Geoscience from Montclair State University, New Jersey. I really love it when scientists write poetry. There's a special connection there. Her husband of 60 years, World War II veteran, died in 2013. Her first book of poems, Reflections, published by Tall Trees Press, was in 2009. Can be obtained on loan from the Noah Webster Library in West Hartford. And her second book, To the Far Country, is available now, correct? It just recently came out in 2016. So I would like to present June Sidran Mamlekar.
Thank you, John. The other facts, and they have a little stool for me to stand on. as Tom said, I was one of the original four people who showed up at the Facts and Branch Library one day in 2002. We were all women, and I'm the only one still left standing here before you. I mean, they're left, but they're not here. I have been at every one of these meetings since 2002, and I have been in every anthology that we've had, and as Tom said, I am the co-editor. My husband of 60 years, whom many of you may remember because he was always with me, Bob Mandelkern, died 3 years ago, and I want to read this poem in his honor. Artifacts. The toy monkey grins at me from its perch on the headboard of my bed. Improbably pink, bought for a visit to a toddler that never occurred, he joined the cheerful group of small stuffed animals that comfort me each night since you are gone. Here is the brown moose with tan antlers from the hotel shop in Vermont where we celebrated our 55th anniversary when you, already unable to walk to restaurants and shops in town, were shepherded by car the few steps required. Here is the sturdy buffalo, symbol of the American spirit, wild prairie grasses and open plains, I bought for you in Wyoming on a trip you were not able to join. Here is the sad-faced dog, given to you by a friend after one of your hospital stays, resting its chin on the worn fabric, floppy ears dangling and short black tail bravely aloft. And here is the white bear, with blue Jewish stars on the soles of its feet and a happy Hanukkah sign across the chest, brought to our door by kind members of our synagogue during your long last illness. Above is the three-dimensional dream catcher with 12 strands of turquoise ribbons purchased long ago at the gift shop of an indigenous tribe on the Olympic Peninsula, when time had no meaning and the future stretched before us, unending and free. Artifacts of our story, I honor them as they soldier on, require no sustenance but the blessing of memory, which happily has not yet been taken from me. I published my second book of poems, To the Far Country, just last month. It is available on Amazon. And the far country is that country to which we are all headed. Some of us will get there sooner than others. The country of growing older. I wonder if I could read two poems as quick as I can. One is called... on the subject of the far country is called The Brave Ones. The country of old age is not for faint of heart. Guideposts are gone. Each wanders his own field daily to reinvent the wheel. New paths are forged, burdens of the past carried toward a future wrapped in fog, mined with unknown fears. Our children cannot save us. They live in their own dimension. We smile, invite each other to lunch, return to our quiet homes to count our blessings, while deep in the shadows, the monsters wait, the wild things still out there. We cry to the wilderness, hear our call, behold, notice us, see us. We are the warriors. We are the brave ones who stumble through the night, defenseless and unarmed, toward a dawn that may never come. But not to end on such a down note, this poem is in the anthology and it's called Carousel. The carousel of life spins fitfully. I fear I have overstayed my welcome. Attendants are long gone. My ticket of admission is expired. All dues are overdue. The world circles past, muted and gray. I am an observer, participant no more. Perhaps there may still be time for some kindred folk to step on board to join me. Perhaps some unknown master plan remains to be evolved. Perhaps the signal purpose of my life is yet to be revealed. The carousel turns, I wait, with anxiety, anticipation, and against all reasonable odds, with hope. Thank you.
June Citron Mamakernan, you got books I think I saw over there too. Paraphrased Hunter S. Thompson, life is a wild ride, make sure you buy a ticket. That's what that poem reminded me of. The next poet is Raymond Marafina, and this is what I was given to say. According to Ray, he'd like to say he does his best mostly. Raymond Marafina.
Thank you. I thought I'd save 20 seconds by cutting all the other stuff out. So, I don't know if I did. Anyway, you're watching or looking at a guy who's finishing his rookie season with the Facts and Poets, and I look in the mail every day, Steve, to see if I have a renewal for next year. He's the general manager, sort of. I have a poem here that I'd like to read. It's about some people I knew when I was a young man in my teens in Waterbury, Connecticut. And one person that I read about in, or read about in books. It's called A Path. This is a monstrous thing here. A path often summons by needs. Am I audible out there?
Yes.
Willie of the gates and Willie of the church, each born into mental shadows, both mostly bemused and cast permanently in chains of near muteness, but each the silent guardian of a notable summons, one Willie to close every neighborhood gate on the home street, the other Willie to walk a severely uphill mile to church. Their punctuality established daily throughout the seasons. These two refugees from most of the everyday transactions of play, school, and work nonetheless had their summons partnered locally with those of us solipsistic keepers of our own lives. I couldn't walk those hills every day, or anyway, he lets us know the time, or here he comes again. Gate Willie, fated to remain forever unmated, even with the most basic ideas of or marriages common, instead mated latches that had been temporarily loosed from their ordained couplings. Each call to task anticipated and silent. Church Willie climbed daily to be greeted by Jesus at a Eucharistic moment, followed immediately by a visit to the faucet in the vestry for his drink of water, very audible and needed to loose the wafer that was now tenaciously vaulted. The rest of us stuck, just watched and waited for Willie's return to his front pew. I absorbed all this evidence as evidence of a humanity as essentially good and only corrupted from the outside. So, unstuck now, I have been drawn to, among others, Monsieur Rousseau. A cap tip to you, Gate Willie, and Church Willie, and friendly keepers living along those hilly streets, and Jean-Jacques, among others. And if I may, a shorter poem that appears in Perspectives 10. It's about climbing a barn to about the second floor to replace the clothesline every 3 or 4 years that broke. I used to do that on a regular basis until one day I looked up and thought I was too old for this. It's called Replacing Clotheslines. The barn invites a certain type to climb its side with wheel and sash to risk a reach or slide and finally pin the virgin line. That type has mind and limbs to act without constraints that slow the ones who gauge potential cost against the results. That type toes rungs the way that birds take rest on sash that spans the space between the pins. They see the work up close, with mind and muscle fixed. No height, no sway will bargain stringing acts. But others see beyond that line to where horizon creeps upon the bird who stays brief, upon the ones whose space grows short. Thank you.
Thank you. That was Raymond Marafino. Really enjoyed that. Nice to hear narrative poem, the first one. David May is our next poet. He hails from the town of Newington and has lived in the Hartford area since 1981. He's currently an adjunct English instructor at Central Connecticut State University and at Lincoln College in New England. David was published previously in Listen, 1998, Kingswood Oxford School, Helix, 2003, Central Connecticut State University and the Newington Town Crier. And he gathers inspiration from the classics Langston Hughes, Robert Frost, and Toni Morrison. I would like to bring up David May.
Thank you, Tom. I just want to thank everyone of the Facts and Poets for putting up with me and helping me to share my poetry with you. It means a great deal to me and has helped me a great deal in my writing. I'd like to read poems from Perspectives 10. The first one is called Listening for His Voice. This is dedicated to my father. As I wrote the poem, I was very inspired and very and motivated with the topic. And as I, what happens with lots of writers that when they go out into the world to face an audience, they become aware of a lot of other issues. And as a teacher, I realized that many kids today don't have that kind of relationship anymore. This kind of bond with fathers is changing a great deal. Some are lucky to have fathers, some are not. And I just wanted to share this, and perhaps through my experience with and my students and others can have that kind of experience that I have, or enjoy that, or appreciate that experience. This is called Listening for His Voice. This stays with me like breakfast in my mama's kitchen, how my father read aloud to us from the Bible on Sunday mornings, his hands rough, heavy, and strong from years of work, moving so carefully across the thin pages, as if he carried a flashlight through a dark house, searching for familiar passages, those his father read, passages read and sung aloud in solemn voices, gathered in quiet, sunlit Sunday meetings I had not known. How the Lord first called Adam, then Noah, and Abraham, and Isaac, and Moses, and the one he called his own. This lingers still between the visits and the absence that came, how he called my name, and in an instant, I was home. No other voice spoke the same. In the sound of his voice, there was a floor beneath my feet. His resonance defined the space within the rooms, within the walls of every room. With the sound of his voice, he inscribed his story on my soul. It was his voice calling out warning from the front porch. His voice on the phone calling from work. His voice in the receiver at my dormitory far away at school. His voice from the hall, welcoming and cordial, reminding me of the path by which I came, simply by calling my name. So in his absence, I have learned to listen. Because of his absence, I have learned to see. And this endures. In autumn, when I rake the leaves that trees cast down, and the afternoon casts broad shadows across the lawn, his dark presence seems to stand on the periphery, observing me as I pass along. I do not hear my father's voice, yet his words remain, and when I sing an old spiritual refrain, I am mindful of the gospel cadence of his speech, as true and sweet as Cain. I would gladly trade an hour or a single day to hear the vibrato in his song and his words I know by heart. This is a shorter poem, and a lot of her feelings about our home resonate in this poem. We found a place where once in a while time buys lunch from a truck in the park, and autumn glows till dark, and the warmth of a fire still lessens the chill. Here we cuddle for hours in the quiet night, perhaps too long and too late for flight. But just before light, we wake at length to the distant clatter and wails of early cars on the rails. It's far from wrong, but not always right. Never as extreme as it would seem, just enough to resemble the dream. Here December glistens on evergreens till spring. Here, honeysuckle and morning glory can freely cling. In summer, skyrockets climb into blue velvet skies. treading their glitter to dazzle our eyes. Here we mend the rift. We steer the skiff. Though now and then we go adrift. And not too far, and not out of sight.
Thank you. That was David May. And our next poet, correct me if I'm not saying this right, is Carol McCumber. Is that right? Carol has recently joined the Faxon Poets, and this is her first published poem. She has an MA in communication disorders and has worked as a speech therapist and as a librarian. Currently, she is oil painting and writing poetry. She resides in Hartford, Connecticut. Carol McCumber.
One, and also I chose a photo to go with it because I didn't have two poems at the time. This is about my creative process. I am an oil painter, and it's about when you get into that zone of painting. And perhaps some of you can relate to it if you have a hobby or an activity where you just find yourself very, very focused. It's called Flow. I pick up my paintbrush and with narrowing focus, slowly drift into the invisible pull of forward momentum. My brush skims across the canvas, then slows to nudge creamy constructions into being. Together, my painting and I float on the ripply liquid expanse of time. Silent fog wraps a misty cloak around me as I descend into colors. The world falls away, and I submerge into a shared space with my pursuit. We exchange elemental energy back and forth, transforming and being transformed. I linger here, unaware that I am lingering. Only much later, or has it been a minute, do I blink away the undertow and realize that I've been to another world and back.
Very good. That was Carol McCumber. The next poet, David Mello. I see him at a lot of venues. We talk a lot. We have a great time talking. On a personal note, I would like to thank him for, before the program began, coming up and saying, "Tom, your fly is down." That's a sign of a good friend. He could have told me at the end of the program. David Mello is originally from New Bedford, Massachusetts. He returned to Connecticut in the spring of 2010 after living in Austin, Texas since 2001. He has a BS in Business Administration from the University of Massachusetts at Dartmouth, and he now lives in West Hartford. I would like to bring up David Mello.
Thank you, Tom, and good afternoon to everyone. I've been a member of, first I want to say it's very nice to see such a sizable crowd in attendance here this afternoon. I'm sure all the Faxon Poets appreciate you coming out here to hear us today. I've been a member of the Faxon Poetry Group since 2010, and I might add that very proud to be a member and to be associated with such a fine group of talented poetic artists. And I'm going to read two of my poems this afternoon. The title of the first one, first piece, is Across the Border. Midnight falls on Front Street. Heavy fog rolls off the Hudson. Danger floats in the air. Blue guardians walk their beat. In the bowels of the city, steady traffic rolls along. Money passes hands in the dim light of the moon. Nothing here but winos and ladies dressed in red, addicts, old drunks, people of the street, a gathering of the pitiful.
Nobody would be in the audience. People have hung in there. I'm going to read, hopefully, if it's okay, three short poems. The first one I'd like to read is in the book, In Perspectives, Caution Signals. The old cup of empty pens, nibs, pencils, and rusted scissors, fingerprints on an old passport, pocket full of loose urges and criminal DNA. Which cloud pushes my mad question into your weather? Which hungry thought survives grubbed and guttered from one day to another? We tried to move the arthritis of ours, the wind like stones sting, each question bent stiff and homeless, caution lights flashing in the next intersection. I thought, I knew Tom was going to say something about Bloomfield, so I thought I'd better do a West Hartford poem, because I was brought up in West Hartford, went to Sedgwick, went to Conard, and then moved away, and now some 40 years later have returned. So this poem I'd like to share is, I taught for many years, and I always think of all the crazy things, stupid things, non-thinking things that young people do, there's something under them, a current moving into the future. So this is called 16 Cherry Bombs. Oh, and this is interesting because when I got back here, I don't know how many of you remember the Y used to be right on North Main Street here. It's now a emergency care thing. And I met my wife at the Conard Hall dance there, so that now that it's a, I guess that's a next stop, healthcare. 16 cherry bombs. Lucky Strikes, Levi's, white t-shirt, Leslie's black hair, Latin class. Me on street corners, hitchhiking. 103 miles an hour up Route 44. Why on Friday night? She asked me who I am. I know she knows. I don't care. Drive-in movies, HUD four times, six packs of Pabst Blue Ribbon, painted shoes and a spit curl, and rolled up anger in my sleeves. 1 a.m., shoot cherry bombs from slingshots at the cop in my elbow. Wanting to be a cherry bomb, shot out of a slingshot into night. The last one is just, I always read this one because I don't know why I like it, but I like it. So. If God steals me, will there be an Amber Alert? Do you become who steals you or who looks for you? Amber prayer beads roll over the fingers of the restless Palestinians near the Damascus Gate. Their fingers linger in my body. Late at night, when they are restless, they inflict pain. For every wound that I've inflicted, there is a scar on me. Where do I go for succor when they suppurate? They say all wounds heal. That's what they say. But on this night, I know, they know, nothing. Thank you.
Thank you. That was Garrett Phelan. The next poet, Thomas L.L. Hercules Strong.
Thank you, Tom. And Marcia, and Steve, and fellow Faxonites. You hear me okay?
Yep.
All right, that's enough touchy-feely. How many people out there have cats at home? Kitty cats? Okay, so you know that if you have them in your household, there's a certain cat logic that they have that's all their own. You know, kind of like politicians, except cats actually make sense. So I have two at home. I have one piece for you. You notice I said piece and not poem. And I have two bruisers at home. They're the size of Buicks. They're very, very large animals. And when they go at it, they're really hysterical to watch. It almost looks like WWF. You know, they really go at it. They, one tries to best the other. And it's, you know, 3 o'clock in the morning. They're playing with the magnets on the kitchen floor, that kind of stuff. So it's really hysterical. So I kind of decided to make an actual sporting event out of that. I sold tickets. I made a killing. And so I wrote this on that. Think Howard Cosell, for all of you who remember Howard Cosell. This is called Batting Practice. Batting Practice. Hello and welcome. It's an absolutely gorgeous day here at Scratch Post Park, where two of the finest teams in the nation will put forth for this one-on-one competition their most brilliant and agile players. I'm Charles Manx, reporting on all the action you'll be seeing today. Let's start by introducing our two teams from that state farthest north. Please welcome the Maine Coon Maniacs. And from that place that makes devils out of anyone with a nose pad, won't you please welcome the Tasmanian Tabbies. Today's match is sponsored in part by Catnip and Tuck Cosmetic Surgeons, when only the best will do, yes, for that feel younger look. Whiskers getting a little gray, tail starting to droop and lose fur? Let the Catnip and Tuck professionals make you look and feel like that sex kitten again. Catnip and Tuck Cosmetic Surgeons, 1801 Birdcatch Parkway in Fangville. All right, looks like we're about to begin as each team is sending its first players into the arena, prancing in from the left, his fifth straight year under the sofa for the Maine Coon Maniacs. Welcome, Harry Maine. Maine joins us today after clawing his way to a batting average of 9-1. And from my right, taking his own sweet time to reach center stage for the Tasmanian Tabbies, welcome Perlis Jones. Jones comes to the table today after knocking everything off it with a batting average of 8-2, so it could be a very close match today. Whoa, and there's the yarn ball toss, and it looks like straight out of the litter box, it's Jones in the lead. Uh-oh, looks like Maine is regaining. Just to put a scare into Jones, he's jumped into the announcer's booth and batted all our producer's notes into the air. What a disruption. Folks, don't be concerned that this event is going to the dogs. The judges love this. Wow! Jones just did a mid-air dive onto Maine using a reverse BPA move. For all those who aren't familiar with the technical terms in this event, BPA stands for back paw action. And Maine pulls a fast one. He's lifted Jones' food bowl into the air, and now it's raining friskies. Folks, you'd have to be catatonic not to feel the tension and excitement here today. Whoa, and there's the sound of the can opener bringing us to halftime with the score tied at 4-4. What a match. Hey, stick around for halftime entertainment coming up with two national singing sensations. First up, it's country western star Miss Kitty Wells. Next, gracing the stage, it's rocker John Cougar Mellencat. Today's second half is sponsored by From Scratch Used Furniture. Furniture for that already ruined look. From Scratch, 64 Threadbare Lane in Farrelltown. We pause now for station break. Don't go away, we'll be right back. Thank you.
That was great. Andy Wheel, another one. Once again, just like Mr. Strong and Steve Forward, who knows what they're going to come up with each time. And as a cat lover, I really appreciate it. We have two more poets. The next one is not in, the bio is not in the book, but Marcia sent this to me. It's for Glenn Gould. I taught middle school and high school English and very basic Latin in Virginia. I taught GED classes and moonlighted, not in traditional sense, as a corrections officer and deputy sheriff, also in Virginia. My new writing career as a poet is just beginning, and Facts and Poets is the greatest anticipatory event of my life right now, other than seeing my grandchildren, who I think are my muses. And most of the inspiration for my poems comes from them. I have an amazing wife, Peg, and two terrific daughters, Christy and Kate. This is Glenn Gould. George Gould, bottom of the piano. George Gould.
Off into the piano now.
Okay. The first, I've got two poems to read. I actually have three, but I'm only going to read two of them. First one, it's called Ballerina Kate, and it's about my daughter. I was reminiscing, we're trying to find a photo of my daughter for, it looks like a resume or something like that. And I came across this photograph of her as a ballerina when she was maybe 3 years old. So this is what the poem is about. Ballerina Kate, oh happy girl of twirl and whirl, spinning her merry and merry-go-round, balanced, then swirled this girl of a pearl, sailing on songs and softest of curl. Kate's cheeks of round painted apply plum, the supply sounds, the happily hum, taffeta pink flows round and around, feet fast and frilled skimming over the ground. Oh, happy girl, you dance with the clouds, spinning your spell and winning the crowds, dancing away and growing too fast, weaving a memory into the past. My second poem, it's in honor of spring. It's called The Squirrel's Tail, T-A-I-L, with a subtitle of Nuts to You. Squirrels scooted and looted the nuts from the trees and danced through the branches and scattered the leaves, skittered and scampered and scratched up a tree, hung upside down, eating birdseed with glee. Squirrel-proofing measures on feeders don't work. The squirrels only look at those things with a smirk. Hanging ones, clanging ones, the stands that are crooked, they're not even defeated by the ones that are gooked. They run on the lawns, they riff through the flowers, eating my pears and my apples for hours. There's nothing that scares them, no bang, no big rock, no rattle or roller, or smelly gym sock. I tried out the ladder in sad desperation. They stuffed it with nuts for the long hibernation. By the way, I can tell you, hibernation's a myth. They tore up my attic last December the 5th. There's nothing quite like, though, the way that they play. They entertain me for peanuts, so I guess they can stay.
Great. I enjoy writing poetry. Cats, squirrels, what a way to end. It's true about squirrels. The final presenter is Marcia Lewis, and many of you know how responsible she is for what goes on with the Facts and Poets. It really wouldn't exist if it weren't for her. She's been former branch manager at the Facts and Library, recently retired, has a bachelor's in English and master's in library science, and she believes the role of libraries is to encourage sharing, including exchanging ideas about reading, writing, cultural change, and creative process. And she really practices what this statement is. I'm not sure exactly what you're going to read. It might be a composite poem.
The high, the treble, and the mellow bass. The rhyme is on time and it is dope. You ask me if it's stupid and I say no, it is qualified. They try to win deny, they try to kind of hide the pain they will apply. Yet you see that it is me, cold rocking on the mic, the MIC. And this is the golden age. When I'm in the city or on a stage, I grab the microphone to the crowd's delight. It's deaf poetry that I recite. Rack the alphabet from A to Z with my verbs and nouns. You remember me. The party is smooth from coast to coast, cause I'm the MC who's chilly ghost. And the way I'm on a double time, and it's really correct. Your respect. MC aggravation is what you feel, cause this demo cut is really real. You know it's me, a little tough time. I mean no confusion, a little alarm. I'm from the West Coast, but I'm in New York and I'm the chilly most, and I'm came to the town to boogie down and rock it to the funky rhythm of the hip hop sound. I'm not known to be the best, of course, but I'm practicing to be the inner source of rhyme. And I copathetically will grind to the hardcore money is earned the one time for the people all over standing in the crowd to cheer, shout out loud. And I'll be proud, and I hope they will too. And my honey, my girl, then I hope she make fine. rhymes is mine, and we design. And as well as I'm wearing my clients sometime, I'll be wanting to take back to where it began. Then you see the beats fat. Now here I go, for the people in the party. It's me, LL Tough Tom, everybody.
Confess that Steve Olek that makes me do it. He says the deadline is now, and a week later he says now. He says now, and I finally pull something together and send it on. But the group has really been inspirational to me in making things happen. And there will be a toast passed around right now, so just hang on to it. Don't worry, it's non-alcoholic. So we'll have a toast in a few minutes. My poem is entitled Writing My Way Out of Town. Writing my way out of town, undoing knots of lost tumultuous and dotty to-do lists, being kept tight in familiarity like a fist. Not all of a sudden, but some of a sudden, the colors change. Both stoplights and leafy mosaic below road shift. Glorious, the amber glow begins to show a new network of getaway routes. The humdrum exit is blocked. The GPS gulps. So with glee, proceed for a breakaway trip. Like in Scrabble, exchange all consonants. Confident, go for the spill. Spontaneous surprise, a little strife. Do you think if you change your poem, you could change your life? No Hansel here, no stones or bread to wind my way home, even if I wanted, but words dropped like leaves, nudged the amber juttings cluster and scatter crisply, wholly into a newly mobile clutter. I prefer to get lost quick, to escape like the owl, straight up, aloft, look, blink. Away. And I have to give credit. There's one line in there that's not my own, but really came from the Facts and Poets. Actually, Steve Olekna. I remember sitting in our workshop one Saturday morning, and he was thinking about two different options he was going to suggest to the poet. And he said out loud to himself, just musing, he said, "Do you think if you change your poem, you could change your life?" And I remember my jaw dropping because I think you can, and I think it does. So thank you, Steve, for your questions. We always listen. At this point, does everybody have their toast? Okay. I have one other poem to read, and this one I think of is sort of like a found poem. Just the odd things of quirky lines you hear here and there. I know you know what I mean. This one is untitled at this point. Chaos scatters tragedy like confetti. We're on this planet without any clue. You are me and I am you. Paradigm your view. I am of yellow, surprised, surrounded by others like me. We're on this planet without any clue. A special no strings attached perk. Because of absence, I have learned to see the moon with its pitted face, its wide leer. At least her soul remains here. Migrating geese wave goodbye. I feel the vast emptiness. Really, it won't take long. Just close your eyes. I'm too spent to cry. An example of what can be formed when one word decides to try. Because of absence, I have learned to see who rests elbows on sills and wonders. I reset myself serene. He's in the between. I realized a gimcrack otherworld against all odds with hope. I realize I've been to another world and back. Take a final turn under the exit sign. I do not get another turn at bat. Is this the end? Is it so complete? It's a fly beats right off the street. Ah, okay. Well, if you haven't figured it out, that's not really me. That's a composite poem taken from lines of the Facts and Poets. I think of it as the best of the Facts and Poets, so just so you know. I thought about having you all read aloud together maybe next year. You can do that instead of me breaking it down this way, but we'll see. Why don't I read it one more time, and I will acknowledge the poet whose line it is, and if you want to fess up to it, you can wave too. All right. And I have to admit, like last night I read this and I had to add someone's line because I left somebody's out, but we'll see how this goes. Okay. Chaos scatters tragedy like comfort. Confetti, that's Dolores Lawler, who's not here today, so excuse me, let me start again. Chaos scatters tragedy like confetti. We're on this planet without any clue. Andy Hook. You are me, and I am you. Joanne Bauer. Paradigm your view. Joyce Bogdan. I am of yellow, surrounded by others like me. Lynn. We're on this planet without any clue. Andy. A special no strings attached perk. Steve. Because of absence, I have learned to see. David May. The moon with its pitted face, its wide leer. Melody. At least your soul remains here. Garrett. Migrating geese wave goodbye. Francis. I feel the vast emptiness. David Mello. Really, it won't take long. Just close your eyes, Andy Weil. I'm too spent to cry, Mira. An example of what can be formed when one word decides to try, Jerry Howard. Because of absence, I have learned to see, David May again, who rests elbows on sills and wonders, Camilla. I reset myself, serene, Pamela. He's in the between, Mira. I realize the gimcrack otherworld, Ray. Against all odds, with hope, June. I realize I've been to another world and back, Carol. Take a final turn under the exit sign, Cheryl. I do not get another turn at bat, Robert. Is this the end? Is it so complete? It's the fly beats right off the street, Hercules. He's gone. What a good way to end it. Oh, you're in the back. So thank you, Bats and Poets. All right. Maybe I'll take a little toasty thing too. And at this time, I think I'd like to. Offer a toast, a celebration toast to you, the Facts and Poets. You've done it again. I mean, once again, you know, you pulled together a compilation that you really outdone yourself. And I just have to tell you, you know, you, the members of the group, how special you are. Each one of you is unique and you bring your own qualities, your own voice. And more than ever, I think that I'm really very aware of your individual creativity and humanity and courage, I would say. The group has really been meeting 14 years, but with this publication, it's reached a whole new level. So thank you for making this happen. And I do want to shout out a couple special people. Steve Olechna, certainly multi-talented spark, the force who makes this happen every year. You all know he also coaches Little League Baseball. He can do anything, it seems, so he may have us do something next year that's completely different, who knows. Joe Molnar is a Facts and staff member who created the cover for this year. A special shout out to June Mandelkern, our friend who was one of the founding members, and her new book is amazing, To the Far Country, available on Amazon. Another early group member I just wanted to mention, Frances Cheng, who every year has come with me to Faxon's Coffee Talk with the mayor and the town councilors there. Yes, and he sings a poem in greeting on the behalf of Faxon to the community. So it's great, Frances. Everybody appreciates that. Thank you so much. To Joanne Bauer for your special skills in bringing together the interviews and what you've been doing with us on the television station. We really appreciate that. And for Andy Weil, who's probably the most famous among us, if you don't know, and I think there will be more famous sightings of him ahead. He's like a one-man show. So for all of you, and for the unnamed rebellious spirits among you, you know who you are. Thank you so much for making this happen. It takes you all. Namaste. We salute the creative force within you. Thank you so much. Here, here.
Thanks so much.
Thank you.
Here's
to Marcia. Okay. Here's to Marcia. Yes, thank you. This has been such a delight. You guys are really the best. Any announcements we have before we take our break? Tom, did you have something?
I had two. Candy Carl of East Haddam Stage Company asked me to present some flyers here. There's a writer's retreat at Gillette Castle State Park. There's information about it here. You can pick up a flyer. Also, Wintonberry Library in Bloomfield, where I co-host the library series. There's Wintonberry workshops, poetry workshops with Lisa Mangini on May 5th and May 12th. They're free. Just call the Bloomfield Library about information about it or check out their website. I didn't have flyers for it. There's one here. And the final thing is I'll be hosting the Oxford Arts Poetry Festival. Andy Weil is one of the performers for that. And that's on May 22nd in Oxford, Connecticut. Most of the flyers are gone. There's one left if somebody wants it.